In this mini lecture, we are going to talk about Coulomb's law. Sometimes I refer to this as Coulomb's law, the Coulomb force, or the electric force. They're all the same thing. Coulomb's law describes the electric force between two stationary charged particles. Our Coulomb force is directed along a line joining the two particles, and it's inversely proportional to the square of the distance between our charged particles. It is also proportional to the product of the magnitude of the charges of those two particles. So if our charges are of opposite sign, the electric force is an attractive force, which means that that force is going to want to pull those objects together. If our particles both have the same sign of charge, they're both either positively charged or both negatively charged, then the Coulomb force is a repulsive force, and those two particles are going to want to push away from each other. So for example, here we've got two negative charges. Because they both have the same sign, the Coulomb force is a repulsive force. And the force vectors, because force is a vector, so our Coulomb force is also a vector, those force vectors are going to be pointing away from each other. Here we have two opposite charges. Between two opposite charges, that Coulomb force is going to be attractive. So the direction of the forces for the electric force are going to be toward each other. Okay, so this is our force vector. If this is charge two, this vector that we're looking at is the force that charge one exerts on charge two. And we'll use the formulation that we would call this F sub one, two. It's the force from charge one on charge two. Since this is a repulsive force, that force is going to be off this direction, along a line directly between the two charges, but opposite. And this force down here is the force that charge two exerts on charge one. And that force is also repulsive. It's going to want to try to push those two particles away. And so this force is going to be directed opposite of charge Q2, okay? And so this is also an example of Newton's third law from last semester. For every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. These forces are equal in magnitude, which means that they're equal in size, but they're opposite in direction. So the force that charge one exerts on charge two, and the force that charge two exerts on charge one are equal in size, but are opposite in direction. Same thing for down here. You see that the force vectors are the same size, but they're pointing in the opposite direction. Here's our repulsive Coulomb force, and here's our attractive Coulomb force between two like charges. Now here's our equation for Coulomb's law, that the force between two charged particles is K, which is the Coulomb constant, times the charge on the first particle, times the charge on the second particle, divided by the distance between them squared. We've got these vertical lines here because this gives us the absolute value. It gives us the magnitude of the force. The magnitude of the force is given by this equation, where we don't care about the charge signs. We don't care about whether or not the force is attractive or repulsive. We just want the size of the force. You would use this equation. K is our Coulomb constant. It's a value that depends on the medium that surrounds the charge. And we're going to always assume that this medium is air or a vacuum. And the Coulomb constant for air or vacuum is 8.99 times 10 to the 9 Newton meters squared over Coulomb squared. This is on your equation sheet. And so R here is always the distance between our charges, okay? And Q1 or Q2, those are the charge on both of the particles. So again, if our charges are of the same sign, then the force, the Coulomb force, is repulsive. The Coulomb force acting on both of these is repulsive if They are opposite charges. The Coulomb force between them is attractive and they want to pull together. And so remember the formality for what we're going to use to label the forces is that F(2,1) is the force that charge two exerts on charge one. And we draw it at charge one and it's pointing towards charge two if we have attractive forces here. And then for our second charge, we've got the force that charge one exerts on charge two. And we draw the vector from charge two, that's the second number here. That vector is going to be pointing toward the other charge because these are opposite signs of charge. So we're gonna have attractive forces. We're gonna draw those force vectors to be pointing in toward each other so that those two particles when they come toward each other. So with that in mind, let's think about this question here. Object one has a charge of -2 nanocoulombs. Object two has a charge of -6 nanocoulombs. So actually, they're both negative charges, so we can kind of think about this system right here. Which of the statements is true? Is the force that charge one exerts on charge two equal to -3 times the force that charge two exerts on charge one? Or are they equal and opposite? Or is F12 3 times greater than -F21? No matter what the charge is, no matter if it's positive or negative, the force that charge one exerts on charge two is always going to be equal but opposite the force that charge two exerts on charge one. That's our Newton's third law. For every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. To better illustrate our Coulomb force, here we have a FET simulation that's going to show us the Coulomb force between two charged objects. Now we have charge one, which has a charge of -4 microcoulombs. And we have charge two, which has a charge of 8 microcoulombs. And it's kind of hard to see, actually, maybe I'll just increase the charge, the size of these charges here. We've got the vector to represent the force on top here. Our force vectors are going to be pointing inward toward each other because this is an attractive force between two charges of opposite charge. They're gonna wanna pull together. The force on charge two caused by charge one is pointing off towards charge one. The force on charge one caused by charge two is pointing off towards charge two. We see that those electric forces are equal in magnitude, almost 250 newtons, but opposite in direction, pointing inward toward each other. If I made this one over here -10 microcoulombs, the force would still be equal in magnitude, opposite direction. Now those forces are pointing away from each other rather than toward each other. Okay, so I'm gonna put it back to where it was there. Now, Coulomb's law is directly proportional to the charge of our objects. You increase the charge, you increase the force. You decrease the charge, you decrease the force. But Coulomb's law is inversely proportional to the square of the distance between them. That means if I decrease the distance between them, I'm gonna increase the force. So let's take a look. Increase the force by a factor of that distance squared. So here we have these two charges separated by a distance of 6 centimeters. We've got our electric force of 250 newtons. I'm gonna write that down, 250 newtons. Let's see what happens when I reduce the distance between them by a factor of three. If I reduce the distance between them by a factor of three, instead of being at 6 centimeters, there'll be 2 centimeters between them. Okay. And when I do that, the force increases. Originally it was at 250 newtons. Now the force between them is, we'll call that 2,247 newtons between them, okay? So I increase the electric force between them by decreasing the distance. Let's see what that ratio is. If I take 2,247 and divide it by 250, That is a factor of 9. I reduced the distance between them by a factor of 3. 3 squared is 9. And so when I reduce the distance between them by a factor of 3, I actually increase the electric force between them by a factor of 9. That's our inverse square law. Then if I increase the distance between the particles, I'm going to reduce the electric force between them.
The electron and the proton of a hydrogen atom are bound to the nucleus by the Coulomb force. We are going to take a look at the size of this Coulomb force and compare it to the size of the gravitational force between our proton and our electron of our hydrogen atom. So here we have a hydrogen atom. The electron and the proton of a hydrogen atom are separated on average by a distance of 5.3 times 10 to the minus 11 meters. So this distance here between them, which I'm going to call r, is 5.3 times 10 to the minus 11 meters. And a hydrogen atom has one proton in the nucleus and one electron that orbits the proton in the nucleus there. Okay, so we're going to find the ratio of the electric force to the gravitational force. So if it says a ratio, we're going to be looking for, I'm going to call this the ratio of my electric force to the ratio of my gravitational force between the electron and the proton. Okay, and we're just going to think about the magnitudes of these, just the size. But in any case, we remember from last semester that gravitational forces are attractive. So because of the gravitational force between two bodies, the electron and the proton want to be pulled together by the gravitational force. But our electric force, our Coulomb force, is also an attractive force if you have a negatively charged particle and a positively charged particle. So our electric force is also attractive, so that wants to pull these two together as well, okay? So let's take a look at the magnitude of the electric force and the magnitude of the gravitational force. So let me just write out that equation here. Our electric force, just the magnitude of it, so I'm going to put the vertical lines around my electric force, which indicates that we're just looking at the magnitude, that equals the Coulomb constant times, I'm going to put absolute value signs around Q1 and absolute value signs around Q2, all divided by the distance between them squared. Okay, that's our equation for the electric force. Our equation for the gravitational force looks very similar. It's also an inverse square law. So we're just going to look at the magnitude. And it equals big G, which is our gravitational constant that is the same throughout the universe, times the mass of one of our objects times the mass of the second object divided by the distance between them squared. Okay? So they both have some constant in them. Our electric force has our charges being multiplied together. Our gravitational force has our masses being multiplied together. And they're both divided by the distance between our two objects squared. Okay? And our objects in this case are the proton and the electron. So let's go ahead and find the magnitude of our electric force here. So our Coulomb constant is 8.99. times 10 to the 9 Newton meters squared over Coulomb squared. Okay, and then we have to multiply that by Q1. The charge on my, let's say Q1 is my proton, okay? The charge on my proton is positive 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 Coulomb, okay? The charge on my electron is negative 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 Coulombs. But actually, remember, we're just thinking about the absolute value of these quantities. So then I'm just going to put 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 Coulombs here for the electron as well. And then we're going to divide by the distance between them squared. And the distance between them was 5.3 times 10 to the minus 11 meters. And we square that. All right, so when we're dealing with our electric force here, our Coulomb force between our charged particles, wow, we've got some crazy scientific notation going on here, right? So you have to be super careful again with how you're typing everything into your calculator. Now, I noticed that some of you are taking the long way around using your calculator to input these quantities in scientific notation. A lot of you, let's say, are typing 8.99 times 10 raised to the 9 in your calculator. Okay, you can do that, but you have to be super careful and be sure you're always using those parentheses to be sure you're multiplying those numbers correctly. You can also write this in your, type this in your calculator by using that big E button. Sometimes it will look like a double capital E, or sometimes it will be a single capital E. So if you type that in, that's the same thing as saying times 10 to the, and then you put the exponent. So 8.99 times 10 to the 9, you could type into your calculator as 8.99, big E, capital E, 9. This is the same thing. And all of this your calculator will understand is one number. It's the same as this thing, it's the same as this thing. And then you don't have to be as careful with typing in all those parentheses. So, and it's quicker than always typing the times 10 to the and raising it to the power, okay? Especially when you have a negative exponent like we do down here. So maybe try to see if you can use this capital E in order to write your type your numbers into your calculator in scientific notation. And if you don't know how to do that, you can ask me in lab and I can show you how to do that. Okay, so if we perform this calculation, we've got C squared on the bottom that cancels with both of these C's, coulombs here. We've got a meter that's going to be squared on the bottom that cancels with this meter squared up here. So my unit is going to be in units of newtons. So my electric force, my Coulomb force here, is going to be in unit, or is going to be, wrong paper, is going to be 8.19 times 10 to the minus 8 newtons. So that's my electric force between the proton and electron of my hydrogen atom. Remember, this is my hydrogen atom. Now let's look at the gravitational force between my electron and my proton. To calculate our gravitational force, this big G is our gravitational constant. Now this is not on your equation sheet this semester. We could fetch our equation sheet from last semester, or you could always look it up in your textbook. It's 6.67 times 10 to the minus 11 Newton meter squared over kilograms squared. This is a constant throughout the universe for gravitational forces. And then we multiply it by the mass of one of our objects and then times the mass of the other object. So let's say that mass one is our proton. On your equation sheet, it tells you the mass of the proton. The mass of the proton is 1.67 times 10 to the minus 27 kilograms. Okay, and then we multiply it by the mass of the electron. On your equation sheet, the mass of the electron is 9.11 times 10 to the minus 31 kilograms. Okay, and then we divide it by the distance between our masses squared. And that distance was 5.3 times 10 to the minus 11 meters squared. So our meter squared cancels here and here. Our kilogram squared cancels with these 2 kilograms. So we're going to be left with units of newtons. And then plugging all of this into our calculator, the gravitational force between the electron and the proton and the helium atom is 3.61 times 10 to the minus 47 newtons. Wow. Okay. So on the small scale, some of the smallest scales in the universe, the electric force, even though it's small, the electric force is many, many, many orders of magnitude larger than the gravitational force. Now, the opposite of is true when we're thinking about the largest scales in our universe. For example, let's think about the sun and the earth. Between the sun and the earth, the electric force is going to be much, 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 much smaller by many orders of magnitude than the gravitational force between those massive bodies. So on the largest scales of the universe, usually the gravitational force wins, but on the smallest scales of the universe, usually it's the electric force here that's going to win. So if we take the ratio of our electric force to our gravitational force, Fe over Fg, we have 8.19 times 10 to the minus 8 newtons, and we divide it by 3.61 times 10 to the minus 47 newtons. So when we have a ratio, our units are going to cancel. And so we find that the electric force between the electron and the proton in our helium atom is 2.27 times 10 to the 39 times larger than the gravitational force between the electron and the proton in the hydrogen atom.